friend of Eleanor Roosevelt, who was a lover of Eleanor Roosevelt, named Hick, Lorena Hickok, Hick for short. And Eleanor Roosevelt started giving press conferences just for women buyers out and out of
and there was enough of them. There were enough of them so that she could
Martin
do that.
King and Byron Preston were mm-hmm. lovers.
So, and then you just, like, when you read about somebody like Byard, you read even about people working with him that were just extremely accomplished and had done a lot of things.
Right.
So, man, we just try and catch up with everything. So, oh, man. So we've only gotten to the 1960s with Byard.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so one of the things that happened, was Adam Clayton Powell, and I need to go back and read, before we talk about the 1964 election, I should go back. Huh? Okay. Okay, cool. Awesome. There was, the 1964 Democratic Convention was fascinating. And then I had friends that remember it. That was so cool, just about the Voting Rights Act and things that were happening then, but basically a deal. My lesson that I took from learning about Byard was that, okay, the civil rights leaders and heroes, they were faulty. They had drama. They had issues. And I get so fed up with community projects and people and all that. So when I learned about Byard and I learned about its internecine problems in the civil rights movement, I was like, okay, these are the great people that I admire. They had problems with each other and they kept going, so I can do it. It makes me like, you need
right.
to keep going, you need to keep trying to work with people. So
right.
that was that, you know, not going out and just thinking about what you do. Like, Byard could have gone out and, like, demonstrated against the Vietnam War
right.
and pissed off President Johnson and not been able to get any of his agenda across.
Right.
So more people have know about Byard because of the film. And then in 2013, President Obama awarded Byard a Presidential Medal of Freedom posthumously. So that got him some more attention. And I'm working on doing the Byard Rest in Day. And so I was at a Unity Day over the weekend, and State Senator Bill Dodd was going around. So I went to ask him if he would if he would write to us or if he would do will you send us a statement for Byard Rest in Day? And I was telling him about it. About Byard, and so now that I can say Presidential Medal of Freedom 2013, that definitely makes light bulbs.
Now tell me this. Do you think they're ever going to make a movie?
About Byard?
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, God, it would be great.
Yeah, they should.
He's...
Now tell us about this music now. Why
okay.
did you choose...
Okay, the reason I...
That's how down is dirty
because
people
it's opera, and but I think that some of it is really old. It's not even so much opera as we know it, as you think of opera as being a 19th century or something. It's even older than that. I just think that if you heard it out someplace, you might not think it was opera. That's why I'm so interested in this particular thing. But you caught right on. So
right on.
So okay, well, should we pop something on?
Yeah, let's do it.
Film that I'm gonna bring here to Vallejo. Very excited. It's called You Don't Have to Ride Jim Crow. And okay, so I've talked about this before, but okay, so briefly is. Morgan versus the state of Virginia was a legal was a legal case brought by a woman named Irene Morgan, who was writing the Supreme Court had ruled that buses that were going interstate couldn't practice Jim Crow. That was the legal. They used a clause. You have to come to the film of this clause of the Constitution about interstate commerce. And so we talked about this before, like basically using the logic of, you know, this is a business, or states affect each other. So Bayard Rustin and a group of his colleagues decided to go to the South, but not the Deep South, because I guess they knew they'd get killed there. But they were taking their lives in their hand, going through the South. So it was 20. It was 20 people. It was 10 pairs: a white person and a black person. And they went to. It was all men. There were women that wanted to go, but they knew. I mean, if they brought women and had, like, people were so crazy about, like, the races, you know, the races mingling, like, about sexual stuff, they were like, they definitely would have been killed, or more definitely. So that's what they did. And so and there's a lot of different stuff that happens, so that, you know, they planned it out, like of people that were sitting, like, in the middle and in the front and in the back. And the plan was that they were, because, I mean, what direct action is, it's like knowing you'll be arrested. So they planned to be arrested, and they thought that the NAACP would bring a legal case, would challenge it legally. But the NAACP didn't. They said that what happened was they didn't get the ticket stubs, which they needed for evidence. But, you know, as we've talked about before, the NAACP didn't want this to happen, because they were just more on the law-abiding thing. Like, right. Okay, we got this, this passed, don't go try and do this just to do it.
Right.
You know, but that's the thing about, right, social movements. There's a lot of different tactics. And so what this film is the people, some of the members of that group that are still living went and retraced their steps, and so that was documented, and they talked about it. So that is what we're going to be showing with
Now, when do you plan on showing this film?
January 10th, 2019.
Where?
The Empress Theater.
Yes.
And I'm planning to have a showing for seniors and a showing for youth. I'm really pleased. Well, I have to watch the film again myself. I think I finally got, I mean, because for me, I mean, I, like, I know I want to book it, I mean, because I'm so interested in the area, but I have to look at it again. So I finally got to see it online. But I want to look at it again and, you know, see if I think it'll be a good film for kids. Rustin, it's about the other people too. The documentary about Byron Rustin talks about him being arrested for being gay, and so, I mean, I wouldn't show that documentary to a young audience, unless to a youth audience, unless there's a group of gay kids. There's, like, social groups of gay kids
Right.
You know, I'd show it to them, but I certainly wouldn't do a youth showing with that issue. You know, just because, you know, I mean, that just something that parents need to explain to their kids. So that's the problem with one of the issues with educating young people about Bayard Rustin. But And I want to bring it, you know, just to try and bring in different communities.
Makes sense.
Yeah. But, I mean, Robin Washington does other stuff, too. He has some criminal justice reform projects, too. So, I mean, I told him I could set up events for him about that, too.
Yeah.
So I do have something to be working on. So, yeah, I totally got on a roll earlier. I went off on that tangent. Once I went off on that tangent about Leyland Olds and stuff, I'm like, no, I have to get this better prep. You know, and they're really, you know, like, of the conflicts or the countries that we've been following, I mean, you know, nah. There's a lot of holding patterns, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
So we're gonna make sure me and you are gonna work on a grand show towards the end, right, Joe?
Fired would be. Now it's even more upfront. You know, I'm sure he would have been here. You know, you're not black enough. You're not gay enough. 1964. Okay. He ghost wrote the "I Have a Dream" speech.
Right.
He helped Martin Luther King write it.
Did not know that.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
And they don't talk about that either.
They sure don't. Mm-mm. They sure don't. And one of the things that's really cool in the documentary about Byard is interviews from his assistants and people that worked for him about doing the march. And, you know, my God, did they even have, like, copy machines back then? It's, you know, okay, this was people, like, typing stuff out and mailing things and organizing buses and bringing people in. I mean, it kind of makes my head spin just thinking about it.
Well, you know, though, but they had a lot of small towns back then. It seems like they were good at getting the word out.
That's true.
I don't know why, but it just seems like back then, like, now it's hard. It seems hard now, and we have a lot of stuff to do it.
That's true, because we're not as distracted. Because there's so much distractions.
Right.
There was also, I'm like, oh man, I think we, this would be good for the podcast. There was a very active black press. There's a lot of black magazines and journals back then.
Right.
And they were very active. And one of the things I've learned about, which I'll talk about perhaps more next time, was about the Defender, which was an African-American journal, and it would be informing people about activism, and the paper itself was activism.
Mm.
And it was sleeping car porters would carry it and would distribute it to people to get the word out that way. And they would get people to subscribe. And so the people that were part of the story were making the story.
Right.
And, like, with the Defender, if they would send reporters down to cover lynching trials in the South, and the reporters would have to be watching out not to get lynched themselves.
Right.
So the Crazy. Defender, oh God, the Defender was just fascinating.
So how do you think they were able to do it, being like black reporters? How were they able to get these stories without getting, you know, without having to go through a lot of stuff going on? How do you think they were able to do it?
I think that the past was different than we might think of it. And that, you know, there was racism and segregation, but I don't know, people were all, there's just a lot more out there than we realize. And so, when I was reading about the Defender and Robert Abbott, the founder, there were associations of black journalists.
Right.
There were like a lot of black papers at the time. So it just told me that people were a lot more active than we heard about.
than we might have thought about. And it's the same with women, okay? I really feel like there were practically, like, more women, like, women had more power in government in the 1930s than they do now. I mean, because when I start reading, like, FDR's labor secretary was Frances Perkins, who basically designed the Social Security system.
Right.
And she had a lot of women that she worked with. And, like, I've read about a journalist